Good afternoon, everyone. My name's Tim Fortier. I'm the Communications Coordinator with New Hampshire Municipal Association, and thank you so much for joining us for our 2024 webinar series. And this is part of our Local Solutions to the State's Housing Crisis, second in a series of five webinars. This particular webinar is called The Intersection of Development and Clean Water. I would like to turn the program over to Noah Hodgkins, moderator for this series and also principal planner with the Office of Business and Economic Affairs. We will be taking questions. You can put them in the Q&A chat box. We will be addressing those questions at the end of our presentation. So we encourage you to stay with us to the end for any questions that you are seeking answers to. And with that, I'd like to turn the program over to Noah Hodgkins.
Well, thank you so much, Tim, and thank you everybody for joining us today. First, I just want to thank the many sponsors and partners that are for the series that include my office, the BEA, New Hampshire Municipal Association, CDFA, Plan New Hampshire, the Center for Ethics and Society at St. Anselm College, UNH Cooperative Extension, the Community Loan Fund, New Hampshire Housing, the New Hampshire Planners Association, and the New Hampshire Association of Regional Planning Commissions. Today, we are joined by Rob Taylor, who is the Land Use and Community Development Administrator for the Town of Enfield in the Upper Valley, and Brandon Kernen, who is the Groundwater and Drinking Water Bureau Administrator at the New Hampshire Department of Environmental Services. And with that, I'm going to turn it over to Rob to give the first part of this today's webinar titled The Intersection of Development and Clean Water. Rob, take it away.
Okay, thank you very much. It's a pleasure to be with you guys. Again, I'm Rob with the Town of Enfield. I've put my contact information right here on the introductory slide. If anybody has any thing that they wanted to follow up with, I'm absolutely happy to chat. My office is always open, the door is open, the phone's on, and the email is ready. So please feel free to reach out to me anytime. I know that us in municipal government, we do a great job of sharing knowledge. And so I am here. Just wanted to let you know. Starting out, this beautiful picture, I got to take a helicopter charter last summer and took some really awesome pictures of the Town of Enfield. This one was my favorite. This is Smith Pond, which is in what we call the Shaker Mountain region of Enfield. It's very close to Interstate 89, for those of you that travel up the highway from Concord. It is exit 15, if you ever wanted to come and take a really neat hike. This pond, Smith Pond, is actually a legacy asset of the former Shaker community that Enfield is famous for, and I'll get into that in just a little bit. Smith Pond is sort of the headwaters of what used to be their mill works. They actually operated in the last 200 years, they operated several mills to saw lumber and grind grain and all kinds of different things. And this pond is actually very unique in that it's at the top of a mountain and is absolutely spectacular. You can see the pond in the foreground. And then that's Mascoma Lake down in the distance. And I think that's why I was asked to be a speaker today, is because Enfield is sort of famous for our water. And of course, that is a great asset for us, but is also a great liability. We've got a lot of work to do to protect these assets. And it's sort of right where my job sits to work to obviously balance the development with the quality of the water and our natural resources. So let's get right into it. We'll start with the next slide. So we'll sort of go back just a bit in history. I alluded to earlier, Enfield's sort of famous for our Mascoma Lake, and even more specifically, a village of Shakers that lived here for many, many years, going back, into probably the early 19th century. You can see in this old photo picture of the Shaker settlement on the shore of Lake Mascoma. Central in that picture, the big picture, you'll see what's called the Great Stone Dwelling, which is still here in town as part of the Enfield Shaker Museum. And that is a spectacular place for those of you that want to come visit. I highly recommend it's an example of communal living, and the Shakers were amazing at many different things, including making of furniture and their agricultural seed production. And so this sort of starts out my presentation to talk about what was going on the waterfront and how those things impacted our life here in Enfield. Obviously, I've alluded to Shaker Village. Early 1840s, the Boston and Maine Railroad came through, bringing train travel from Boston and points south, Concord, New Hampshire, all the way up sort of along Route 4 up into eventually Lebanon and White River Junction, which were major railroad towns. And Enfield was really a railroad town. Of course, agriculture happened extensively. You can see across the lake there in that big picture, some of the big meadows there that are along what we call Shaker Hill. And of course, the Shakers themselves had intensive agriculture for dairy, maple syrup production, and grain, fodder, you name it. They were doing all kinds of really amazing stuff. And then what I get a kick out of as you look across that lake in this picture, it's old enough. You can see that lake shore on the opposite side from the Shaker Village. There's really nothing on that other side of that lake shore. If you were to look at that same photo today, you'd see literally dozens upon dozens of houses and camps and cottages. And so you can kind of see as we start this conversation today where we've ended up. And of course, the little inset photo down on the lower right is what's known as the Enfield Shaker Bridge. That was one of three different bridges that have existed at that site. We've got actually a much newer bridge there now that was built in 2014 that replaced this old bridge. And a little history there, they built the bridge, the Shakers did, originally to get across the lake so they could deliver goods to the railroad depot and have their goods shipped off to points south. And the way they built their bridge back in those days was by walking stones out onto the ice in the wintertime. And when the ice melted, the stones became the base of the bridge, sort of the foundation of the road going across the lake. So that's a little bit about the historic waterfront along the shores. We also have another couple of big water bodies. We have Crystal Lake in town, which is a very pretty, slightly smaller lake to Mascoma. And then we have a couple of ponds. Spectacle Pond is one, Smith Pond that I mentioned earlier, and there's also a pond called George Pond, and there's one called Coal Pond. So we've got a lot of water resources. We have actually identified five of those water areas in town as what we call prime wetlands that are sort of very important assets to the town that are heavily protected with setbacks, extended setbacks, and so forth. Jumping on to my next slide, alluding to it a little bit earlier, the pattern of development in Enfield, we do have a village where most of our sort of downtown assets are, where our town offices are, library, police station, and that's along Route 4, very close to Mascoma Lake. Main Street Mascoma is actually that road that comes across Shaker Bridge. So that is sort of the sort of foundation of our development in town, where most of our early settlement happened. And then there's also a village on the Route 4A side of town called Enfield Center. And as I said earlier, the lake fronts, and you can see it in this picture here, as you look across the lake, you'll see tons of lakefront development. And even this photo is actually a picture of what we call Lakeview condominiums, which are on the shores of Mascoma Lake along Route 4A. This is a village of about 150 two-bedroom condominiums with shared beach access. And of course, Enfield also has tons of dirt roads with 5 and 10 acre subdivisions and lots on those houses. But if you're talking about our tax value and where the grand list gets most of its dollars, it is in the lakefront lots and the downtown. So clicking on to my next slide, I just wanted to show you that old picture I showed you earlier was of this area. This is actually the Shaker Village as it exists today. You'll see about 75 single family homes on individual lots down in the lower left-hand side of this shot. you can see what was called the La Salette religious shrine on the right-hand side. You can see some of their assets on the hillside. That is since closed last year. It closed up and has now been purchased by the Enfield Shaker Museum and will be controlled by them for nonprofit use. But it's interesting, I will point out that this development, that Lower Shaker Village, was originally intended to be much, much bigger. We've got 75 houses out of it. It was originally envisioned to be several hundred. The developers back in the early 80s kind of ran out of gas with regard to additional development, was slated to be up along that hillside to the right. And when that sort of fizzled, that land was acquired by a couple of different entities and actually put into conservation. And so we're sort of excited about that because we actually have thousands of acres now permanently conserved by State of New Hampshire Fish and Game, as well as the Upper Valley Land Trust. So we see that as a, you know, obviously a great win, but it's also would have been some prime land for some housing. And so that, I think, is something that this conversation continues to deal with when we talk about housing in New Hampshire. I think it's something to look at, the success of conservation in this state with land trust and development rights and easements for conservation have actually put a lot of pressure on the housing market, probably unintentionally, but it is no doubt that we need to address that. I actually know somebody that's active with the Upper Valley Land Trust, and they actually, in their board meetings now, see themselves as having to be part of the solution for housing, because they've been part of really successfully conserving so much land that it has sort of made developable land, you know, scarcer as a result. So there it is in a nutshell. As you look at that right there, you can see developed land, but as you look to the right, all of that land, those fields, the hillside, those are off the table for future development. You know, I mean, depends on who you talk to. I think it's great that we have tons of conserved land, but, you know, the pendulum sort of needs to swing perhaps the other way in terms of housing. We got to find places to put housing. So continue that conversation. As I said earlier, Enfield has over 4,000 acres. It's over 30% of our land mass in Enfield that is permanently protected. Fish and Game, they actually manage it for wildlife, which is kind of interesting. There's a little bit of stress there with regard to Fish and Game really wants it for hunting and fishing, you know, for that kind of use. There's a lot of people that love to take their dogs for a walk up there, and they get nervous when they see somebody with a gun up there. But actually, Fish and Game will tell you the guy with the gun is supposed to be there, and the person walking their dog really isn't supposed to be there. The Upper Valley Land Trust land is really a recreational area. It's about 500 acres there that Land Trust controls in our town. And it is really the crown jewel of the Upper Valley Land Trust assets, in that it is that Smith Pond area I showed you earlier, as well as some hiking trails and so forth going up Shaker Mountain. Anybody wants to take an awesome hike, come to Enfield and take a hike up from Route 4A, because there is all of the old Shaker assets, meaning canals and dikes and old dams, and the Shakers will blow you away with their ingenuity and their work ethic, what they were able to accomplish, really with nothing but shovels and backbreaking work. Maybe a few draft animals, horses or oxen. And that was a view looking down from their nature area, looking at Mascoma Lake. This is a quick little thing I wanted to go over. We actually acquired as a town about 3 acres of property along Mascoma Lake on Main Street in Enfield from the state of New Hampshire. It is former asset of the Boston and Maine Railroad. When Boston and Maine gave up all of their property in the railroad line, state of New Hampshire DOT took it over. And now the Bureau of Rails and Transit is what manages that. And we were able to talk them into this sort of adjoining land along what is now the Northern Rail Trail, which is an incredible asset for the state of New Hampshire. But this was really important for the town, because what we've seen in Enfield as far as development goes is obviously privatization of the lake shore and lakefront land in town. So it's sort of become the land of the rich, and regular people are losing out in terms of access to the waterfront. And this was very important for us as a town to be able to grab some land that is now public asset, 3 acres, as I said, about 1,250 feet. And it has formed what we call Mascoma Lakeside Park. And it's now kind of an awesome area. We've built a pavilion. You'll see it in the bottom there. That's available for town events. We do concerts there. You can have a wedding there. You'll see in the right-hand photo, sailboats. We actually have a recreational nonprofit called the Mascoma Sailing Club, where you can have a membership and use their boats and learn to sail. It's actually one of two sailing clubs along the Mascoma Lake. We also have Dartmouth College Varsity Sailing, and they have an incredible facility that's actually going up as we speak, but they've been there for 50 or 60 years. Just quickly, we've been able to secure some private fundraising. We also did a Northern Borders grant for development of our park. The park will also have lots of nature trails. We're trying to demonstrate good behavior along the lake. So we've been doing lots of shoreland permitting. We are going to have nature trails with demonstration of native species for lakeshore. We've had to work with UNH Extension to remove a lot of invasives. We've got a terrible knotweed problem in Enfield, which I'm sure other communities can sympathize with. But we've worked with, we actually have a woman in town who's a master gardener with UNH Extension. She is sort of our point person on this project. And it has been a real success story that I think will be there for generations to come to show sort of a quality usage of the waterfront. We do have, you can see in that picture with the sailboats, you can see there's a little boat ramp for what we call rooftop access, which means kayaks and canoes. And again, I think this is a real win, and it's a notch on our belt for sort of preserving waterfront access for the masses, for the general public. We do also have a town beach just across Shaker Bridge. We also do have a town boat ramp there that we manage. So again, we're really trying to be aware of public access for our waterfront. But getting into sort of the municipal side of things in my job, you know, we're a town, a little town of about 4,500 people. Population swells to about 5,500 in the summer with all the summer residents that come. And it's very interesting sort of post-COVID how that number actually stays a little higher, because I think there's people that have sort of retreated from the cities and actually taken up permanent residency along their lakeshore properties. And so obviously, you know, we're dealing with those people. And, you know, from my perspective as a planning and zoning administrator here in town, it's majority of my job is what's going on the waterfront. We do have municipal services as they relate to development, especially along the shoreland and you know, as they impact water in general. We have a series of municipal wells. It's actually a couple of different well fields that we pump from to a very large feed tank that pressurizes a municipal system, mostly in the downtown area of Enfield. And then we also have a sewer collection system. Kind of a neat story there. Up until about 1970, Enfield did not have a municipal sewer system. And so at that point, in about 1970, the Mascoma River feeding into Lake Mascoma and the lake itself were essentially open sewers. And I have friends and people that I know that can speak to, you know, the lake turning whatever color. They were dyeing the wool at the different mills in town. Enfield's an old mill town, and obviously hydropower was powering the mills upstream of Lake Mascoma. And so the impacts from that industrial use were being felt acutely in 1970. But even to this day, we're still dealing with the after effects. But Enfield was able to use some federal assistance through the Clean Water Act to construct a sewer collection system, which we now collect sewage and pump our sewage to the city of Lebanon, the next door neighbor city, who has a very large wastewater treatment plant. And we own a percentage of capacity at that plant where they can treat our sewage along with their own, We own about 300,000 gallons of treatment capacity, and we only currently use about 70,000 gallons of capacity. So we have some room there, and I think that's starting to get on developers' radar as they look around. Obviously, developers really, really want municipal sewer. And I will just quickly go back to that Lakeview condo complex I showed you earlier. That was kind of a triumph. Originally, when that condo complex was constructed in the late 70s, early 80s, it had private septic system, and they actually had 13 leach fields on that property to service about 150 condos. Well, fast forward to the 2000 teens, and those leach fields were all in failure. So that development was looking down a $3 million replacement of their private septic system. And they came to the town, and we actually worked with them using some USDA money through rural development to actually extend our sewage collection system 2 miles down Route 4A to actually connect them. We've used some creative financing there, including a betterment tax assessment. And as I said, some incredible financing with low interest loans through the feds and even some grant money. So that actually is slowly but surely helping other people along Mascoma Lake on that side of the lake. I'd love to see it extended even further to pick up the whole lake, but it's a very slow and sure march forward for us in terms of progress, in terms of getting people with septic systems private to connect up to our municipal sewer. That is, to me, the biggest factor in water quality in Enfield right now is most of the lakefront properties in Enfield were developed originally as camps and have been sort of gentrified in recent years into more year-round properties. And one way or the other, we've got to get them to upgrade septic systems. I mean, I've got it on good authority that some of the septic systems along Mascoma Lake are 55-gallon drums with bullet holes so that the sewage can leak out underground and make its way wherever it's going to go. Or even better, I've heard that one guy has a buried Volkswagen Beetle in the ground that forms his septic tank with a pipe in the window. So just a little bit for you there. Obviously, other municipal services as they relate, we've got, I talked about the parks, highways, streets. That's a big one. We're doing a lot of dust control and things like that to sort of hold the roads tight. So when these big storms come, that we don't have terrible erosion. We've been successful with that. That's magnesium chloride. Lighting and signage is also on our list of municipal services. Let me clip to the next slide. Developments in development. So in Enfield here, we've done a few things recently that have sort of put us on the map, I think, and we're continuing some of those things. We increased density in our residential, what was called the R1, which is our downtown district of residential district. So we now let you have, if you're connected to municipal sewer, you can take lot size down to 1/4 acre, which doubled from, it used to be a half an acre previously, and that was a 2023 change. Some of you may have heard our increase to 2 ADUs. That's for all single family homes. You can actually have 1 attached or enclosed ADU, accessory dwelling, and you can now have 1 detached. You can actually have 2 attached or enclosed, but our provisions there that you do have to kick into what we call multifamily building code, which presents some challenges, but it's still a great option for a lot of people to add housing in Enfield. For all you that are here attending today, it has not been the end of the world. And don't let anybody tell you that it would be, because it's really just a great option for people. And it's usually shoehorned into existing stock. And you can drive by a property, not know whether it has an ADU or 2 ADUs. And so we're starting to see that sort of get a little momentum and starting to snowball in popularity. I alluded to earlier a little bit about expansion of municipal services. We do have a TIF district in Enfield we've used for expansion of sewer and water, which I think is a huge win if you can do that in your communities. TIF, you got to be careful. We had to be very conservative at the beginning with TIF. You sort of implement TIF and you sort of wait to see whether or not it's going to you know, lift off and actually produce the increase in value that you're hoping for. And that has happened in Enfield and to the tune of millions of dollars. And we've been able to fund a $3.2 million water sewer extension on Route 4. And that is going to help us tremendously with future developments that we're actually looking at as we speak. I will say that we've had a tough time. I'm getting close to the end of my speech for five more minutes here. We've had a tough time in the recent past, and I'm sure the DES guy who's going to speak next will talk to this, and I'm sure all of you have had similar experiences with cyanobacteria. What we're seeing in Enfield, and I think it's representative of New Hampshire and broader New England, United States, whatever, is these storm events that we're seeing are becoming more frequent, more intense, and such that we're actually bringing tons of contaminants into our water bodies and into our water sources. And you would think that counterintuitive, that we would be bringing fresh water into our lakes, that the water quality would go up, but that's not the case. We're actually dragging pollutants and contaminants and nutrients from shoreland into our water bodies, and it's presenting a problem with the cyanobacteria blooms and algae. And Mascoma Lake popped maybe four or five times this last summer. So it's a really big problem, and it's something that we're really trying to get a hold of. And I'll talk about that just a minute, about a couple of other things we've got sort of in our brains and how to deal with this. Exciting. I actually just got an application on Tuesday of this week for a possible development of 308 units that will actually be in our downtown area in the R1, taking advantage of that increase in density, taking advantage of the capacity in our sewer, and obviously bringing tons of housing. Enfield has been stagnant for 40 years with our population. In fact, we've probably slightly gone down in population if you look at the U.S. Census data. So 300 units, if you put 2.5 people in each one of those units, that could be a very significant lift. It could be 700 people in town. So you're looking at, you know, a very significant lift in our population. Continuing to cruise along here, almost done. Talking about what we're up to in Enfield, I will say it's exciting times here. We're really doing some interesting things. We've read the tea leaves, and I'm sure you all have as well. We need housing. Everybody needs housing. There's a short shortage of housing in the Upper Valley to the tune of 10,000 units. In New Hampshire, it's 30,000 plus. So we're deciding that we're going to be part of the solution, and we've actually gone after a New Hampshire HOP grant. We're very privileged and proud to be working with New Hampshire Housing and Plan New Hampshire and UNH Extension to do a rewrite of our zoning. We are going to implement a short-term rental ordinance, as that has started to affect us with all the lakefront properties. Obviously, that's a real balancing act. We're not trying to prohibit. What we really want is to get a handle on safety and sort of also get a handle on what's happening. Right now, we're sort of, you know, in a blind zone where we really don't know what's happening. And so a short-term rental ordinance would require registration and permitting for short-term rentals. Again, not trying to prohibit, but just making sure people are doing a really good job with it. Make sure the fire extinguishers in the kitchen and those kind of things. But obviously, it has an effect. We're also contemplating, well, we're doing a new master plan phase two. We did a one phase earlier that was the first five chapters. We're doing an additional five chapters, and those will include conservation and preservation and things like that. So obviously, having to do with water, certainly. Recreation is another one of our chapters we're working on, which obviously impacts us as well. Here's one for all of you guys. We've talked to the people in Sunapee, New Hampshire. Sunapee has implemented, through just standard regulations, not part of zoning, they have implemented septic system maintenance regulation, which we are actually contemplating as well. And it would be in the 250-foot shoreland protection zone that would actually mandate septic system pumping, which as we look at it, Planning Board has really started to identify that as one of the biggest things we can do for the water quality of our lakes, because it is, as I said earlier, no secret that there are plenty of failing septic systems. And, I'll have people come in my office and say, I haven't had to maintain my septic system in 40 years, haven't had to touch it. And I'll look them in the eye and say, your system's in failure. And they look at me kind of cross it. What do you mean? I don't see any problems. There's no problems manifesting. And I'll say, well, because you're on the lake shore, you would never see it. It's literally making its way right underground into the lake. And, it's kind of hard pill to swallow for a lot of people to realize that they may be actually part of the problem. But that's one thing that we're seriously contemplating. I would even love to see the state, maybe DES, do that, because it really would make a tremendous difference. And really, a septic system is just that. It's a system, and it relies on regular maintenance that we all need to do. And we can't just bury our heads in the sand or bury our septic systems in the sand. So, proud to work a lot with DES. He'll be talking here in just a second. I just would conclude that obviously, we're doing lots of stuff here. We're just a little town, but obviously we all need to play our part. Frustrates me. We've got other communities in this area that are not doing anything. I mean, literally kind of just ignoring this. There's the NIMBYism that we all have to contend with. And in Enfield, it's interesting going through the exercise of the master plan and doing all this work that we're doing. It's really interesting when you get people in a room and you say, here's the problem. And then you ask them, what do you think we should do? Then the solutions that we all sort of know need to happen start to come to light. And you can kind of say, that's a great idea. Thank you for suggesting it. That way it doesn't seem like it's my idea and I'm not forcing it on anybody else. It has to sort of come organically from the citizenry. And, we've got some great partners on the state level, certainly, as well as locally. We've got lake associations and land trusts and Trails Alliance, all these different organizations. So it really does takes a village to solve this problem on the housing and on the water quality. And I will pass it along to my colleague at DES. Brandon? I'll stop sharing mine.
All right. My screen come up okay, Noah?
Got it.
Okay. You were good to go, Brandon.
All right, thank you. I'm Brandon Kernen. I'm the administrator of the Drinking Water and Groundwater Bureau at DES. I've been at the department for 24 years, and I've been in this current role for about 4.5. And I'd just like to talk about some considerations with drinking water and new development. So I'm going to go over some just opening thoughts, some legislation I think is important for planners right now that could affect new development, talk a little bit about private wells in New Hampshire, some water supply planning initiatives in New Hampshire to help support growth and also address contamination, and then lastly talk about how we can protect our drinking water, especially with new development. So first of all, I just have a few opening thoughts. It's something these things have been reoccurring over and over the last few years, and that anytime a municipality is looking at a new development, that as part of the planning board process, the simple question be asked, is there water and is there wastewater capacity? Strangely enough, we see a number of housing developments approved without asking that question, only to see the project design be approved at the local level and not be built because the local wastewater or water supply utility doesn't have capacity. And that's also happened with industrial development commonly in the state. Also, it's really important with new developments, they're seeking a variance, that municipalities be very deliberate in looking at the 5 criteria. Some of our most contentious projects where people are opposing new groundwater withdrawals or maybe a wetlands permit, often were granted significant variances before they even applied for the state permits. So often they're using our state processes to stop something that could have been stopped very easily at the local level if they had the proper master plan and land use planning and also looked at the variance requests carefully enough. And the last thing is PFAS contamination is just an unfathomable issue in southern New Hampshire, and it is frustrating, the ability to approve new small community water systems in that part of the state. It's just a map showing the PFAS situation. These are all private wells that have been sampled by DES. Anything in the red is over, I'm sorry, anything in the purple is over our current standard. And state in New Hampshire has a state standard for PFOA of 12 parts per trillion. And anything in the red is over the probable EPA standard that could come out any day now, at least in the next few months. And so you can see the whole southern part of the state is pretty much impacted by PFOA, mostly from air emissions from two or three locations historically. And what this is causing is when we have a new community water supply well, they have to demonstrate they're not going to be impacted by man-made contamination, a criteria that's been in place since the 90s, a criteria that was established before we had were aware of a problem like this, and it usually wasn't a barrier to developing new community water systems to support new housing. And so we need to look at our rules and see how we can change them to accommodate this situation, because contamination is everywhere and we can't cease approving community wells. And we also don't want to drive developments to put in private wells, which are not regulated and people still have the same exposure. It does get tricky though, because sometimes these proposed community water supply wells, even if we approve them with treatment, could draw contamination into private wells nearby, which is a whole nother matter that we have to figure out how to handle. Another thing I want to talk about is pending legislation that could affect new development relative to drinking water. It's House Bill 1483. And what it does is it proposes a few things. One, it clarifies that when you look at a subdivision at the local level, that you can consider water supply and require a hydrogeologic study. Some feel that the statute's broad enough now to allow this, but this would make it explicit that this could be incorporated into your subdivision plans if a municipality wanted to. It also would allow municipalities to prescribe on-lot testing requirements, and that could be quality or quantity. Again, some do that already right now, but some feel like it needs to be more explicit. We had a hearing recently last week, and it was really positive. Municipal associations supported the bill. DS was neutral, noting that it does address something that's not being addressed now, but it didn't affect our statutes. So we did not take a position. We just provided information. But since the hearing, the Realtor Association and home builders are pretty concerned about this bill because they feel like it could slow down approval process, the process for new housing developments. So yesterday, the legislative committee voted to study the bill this summer, where they will have work sessions to talk about it more. And if anyone wants to be kept up to date on that, they can contact me and I can let you know when that occurs. Whoops, I'm sorry. I forgot to change that slide. All right. Now I want to talk about private wells in New Hampshire. First of all, whenever you have a new well being constructed, either for an existing home or for new developments, it has to be constructed by a licensed water well contractor who has construction requirements and location requirements they must comply with. The pump has to be installed by a licensed pump installer. This is something that's actually violated quite a bit. Plumbers or electricians that don't have a pump installer license often do this work, and they need a pump installer license. And we do see problems with their work, which is pretty serious because that's water connected to high voltage electricity into the interior of the house. Well reports have to be filed with DES. Water treatment at the state level does not require a license. Some towns do require a permit. It's kind of the Wild West that, you know, anybody can open a water treatment company. And it's the one thing that directly changes water quality, and it's the one thing that connects your fresh water supply to your wastewater supply. But in fact, you don't need a license in New Hampshire to be a water treatment installer. There are no standards at state level for water quality in private wells. There's been a legislative initiatives on that, but they have not passed. But municipalities can adopt well testing regulations and a definition of potable water. And we have a guidance document on how to do that. And you can do this by your authority to enforce the plumbing code. And then we have a really good resource. It's sort of a national standard called New Hampshire Be Well Informed. That's all you have to look for on the internet, and you should find it. And it tells you what you should test for in a well. It has a tool where you can enter your results from testing. And then that tool will actually tell you the treatment train and the order of treatment equipment that can be installed to mitigate any health or aesthetic concerns with the water quality. When private wells do have a number of requirements, in addition to what I mentioned before, relative to the location, and this is just a summary of some setback requirements. There are provisions in the rule to let you get closer than these setbacks, but it requires that you put in a deeper well further into bedrock, or I mean, casing further into bedrock to have that distance horizontally and vertically from the thing that you're worried about here relative to the well, protecting the well's water quality. and just sort of a schematic showing that when you do have a well, you have to have a 75-foot radius away from the septic system, and preferably it also be a gradient. For new developments, this should be handled on any new septic plan approval, but it's something that is good to follow up to make sure it's constructed like this, because when we do our septic system inspections, often the well is not installed yet. It's a stake in the ground. So where the well ends up could be different than what you see on the plan. Next, I want to talk about some water supply planning initiatives in New Hampshire that will help support future development. First, we have the South Central New Hampshire Regional Water Supply Study. And what this study is looking at in the southern part of the state is existing supply and demand and future supply and demand. And we work closely with municipalities on that. And you know, essentially what the study showed is there's enough water for the future growth in southern New Hampshire, but we'll have to be careful about where it comes from. Certain major water suppliers are closer to being maxed out than other water suppliers, but they also have interconnections. And so through sort of horse training, trading, we could make sure there's enough water going into the future. And this water supply study sort of paints that picture. The legislature last year funded about $10 million for another Merrimack River crossing to move water from Nashua to the eastern side of the river, which will increase capacity because the water treatment plant in Nashua has quite a bit of capacity from its source in the Merrimack River, and also just from the level that the plant's been designed to treat. There's a study looking at raising the water level of Lake Massabesic, the water supply for Manchester Waterworks. You know, their treatment plant has a lot of capacity, but they are cautious because of the safe yield of Lake Massabesic. If you raise the water level by 1 foot in the lake, it would increase storage by 1 billion gallons. And so that study is underway right now. And there's a pretty big study going that has occurred for Londonderry, and now they're trying to pass warrant articles to extend large water mains in town to extend water to homes on private wells with contamination. But these water supply mains will also be useful for future developments that would otherwise have to put in a small community water system that are impacted by PFAS. There's another study in southern New Hampshire looking at the PFAS occurrence in small community water systems, looking at what makes sense for extending municipal water to these small community systems to address PFAS contamination rather than have 100 plus systems install treatment systems. This would give more sustainable and reliable infrastructure to support growth in the future. It'd be a better use of funds than building lots of little pump houses and putting in carbon filters. There's also a water supply study in the seacoast looking at supply and demand now and into the future, as well as interconnection. And then there's a carve out in the study for municipalities that have water systems. If they want to look at options for coordinating their water system together all the time to improve the reliability and sustainability of the water systems, that they can ask for that as part of the study. And then there's another study in the Concord area looking at what Concord should charge if they supply water to Bow or Pembroke or other nearby communities that have PFAS contamination that will likely have to install treatment plants if EPA lowers the standard. And this is just a picture of southern New Hampshire, the red triangle showing all the standalone small community water systems that would have to put in treatment if EPA lowers the standard for PFOA to 4. The blue lines are the existing water lines of major water systems. And so we're looking at, by the fact that you can extend a line and pick up 2, 3, 10 systems, is it feasible to put in more costly infrastructure to extend water than building all these standalone systems? So next I want to talk about source water protection. Source water protection can involve a lot of things, certainly zoning to protect groundwater, land conservation and setbacks. It's improving stormwater management, managing harmful substances for entities that use them as part of their business. And then making sure you have a lot of public education, planning to protect your drinking water sources, and also to ensure water efficiency, that water is used efficiently when you're approving new projects. So sort of the long view on approving new projects, you want to make sure where the natural environment's being disturbed or sites being redeveloped, that you maximize recharge where it makes sense, that for the impervious surfaces, that you minimize them to the extent you can, and also where you collect water, that it's going back to the site in the form of a recharge. You also want to make sure that stormwater is protected, that the recent contaminants are minimized, and this will ensure that you have long-term availability of drinking water for existing land uses and future land uses. This is just a picture for a development in Somersworth, where you can see quite a bit of housing occurred in an area that was in the natural environment before development, and that through using porous asphalt and also clustering the homes, that you really minimize the impervious areas and were able to closely mimic the natural hydrology even post-development. Just another slide showing how stormwater can be collected in a sort of a bioretention area where you can remove contaminants with the topsoils and promote recharge and again mimic the natural hydrology. And also, these are great educational opportunities where people can recognize that there is a value in capturing and protecting our stormwater, and people can think about that as in their own homes or in their other activities in life. Just another example of development where you can have a new parking lot but still protect water quantity and quality versus sort of the old way of doing things where everything's concrete and hard piped and just ship it out of the watershed as quickly as possible. Another thing to make sure you look at is model groundwater zoning. And we at the state offer guidelines for protecting groundwater through zoning, and it gives you a lot of options on what level to take it to. And many communities have taken advantage of this. 111, by our last count, have groundwater protection zoning in place. And just some of the statutes that allow this are referenced on this slide. Our guidance document addresses all these things on the left that are listed in the left side box here. Anything from having how to define the boundaries to who it applies to what type of uses are allowed and not allowed in an area where you're trying to protect groundwater. Another thing, and this was mentioned by the previous speaker, that we promote is land conservation to protect drinking water. We have a $2 million grant program each year to protect land sources that are important to source water protection areas. So those are areas that contribute water to a public water system. It could be source water, or surface water, or groundwater. Another issue to make sure that's addressed with existing land uses and future land uses is sodium chloride, salt from application on the roads during winter storm events. It's a slow moving disaster in our state. The levels of salts in our groundwater and ultimately our lakes, just throughout the whole state, it's slowly rising. Many cases, very often, you've seen double and triple the levels of salt and water compared to just even the 1960s. And it doesn't appear to be equilibrating at all, that this trend's going to continue. It's bad for aquatic organisms, it's bad for human health, it's bad for our pipes, it corrodes them. And ultimately it's going to cause a treatment problem where there's really no feasible way to remove salt from drinking water. You pretty much have to use a lot of electricity and generate a lot of wastewater if you were to try to treat your drinking water for salt. And to help with that in our state, we have a Green Snow Pro program where applicators can get certified after taking a class and learn about the things they can do to minimize salt applications by calibrating their trucks, by having training on when to apply salt ahead of time or brine before storms, and the type of technology that's available to help reduce salt application during winter events. And then water efficiency, that's a key thing to look at. We have a model water efficient landscaping regulation that municipalities consider about, and it promotes limiting turf areas for new development. If you're gonna have lawns, it recommends topsoil requirements, a certain amount of thickness, which will minimize irrigation needs. And then also technology to make sure when you are irrigating, it is efficient. We also have model regulation to enforce a state law that's pretty unique to Hampshire that enables municipalities to reduce residential lawn watering or restrict it even when there is a stage of drought declared by the state or federal government. And so this, a municipality could only restrict outdoor lawn watering during a drought emergency declared by the state or federal government. But in areas of state where you know you have a water supply problem, where you see wells failing or your municipal system is stressed, you can enact this ordinance, and it applies to everyone, no matter if you're on a private well or on a public water system. You can even adopt the ordinance to target just a certain area of town too, if you're only concerned about certain areas of the town. And with that, I will turn it back over to Noah.
Great. Well, thank you so much, Rob and Brandon. Brandon, you can feel free to actually keep your slides up. That's fine. So we do have about 10 minutes for questions. Before we get to questions, though, I just want to remind folks that this is the series. This is the second webinar in a five-part webinar series. So if you haven't already, I'll put it in the I don't think I can put the link in the chat box, but next week will be the third webinar in the series, YIMBYism, A Different Approach to Development. And we will be joined by Bryce Kawa, who is the planning board chair for the city of Manchester, and Bart McDonough, who is the planning and community development director for the town of Newmarket. Realize some folks may be on vacation next week, but just a reminder that all these webinars are being recorded and will be posted on OPD's YouTube channel and website. So for that, we'll turn to the couple of questions. We have about four questions right now. Again, folks, if you have additional questions, you can put them in the Q&A box. So the first one is for Rob. Rob, do you know what percentage of Enfield is served by municipal water and sewer?
Yeah, it's about 450 customers on the water side and about 600 plus on the sewer side. Interestingly, the reason why we serve more sewer than water is that some of those developments I talked about in my presentation, when they were developed, actually had their own water sources that are still working sufficiently to this day, like Lower Shaker and Lakeview condos. So we've added those customers on the sewer, but they have not added on to the water. So we serve more sewer customers than water, but I don't know, that's maybe 600 out of 2,500 domiciles in the town. So that's not a huge percentage, but significant.
Great. And you have, I think you may have touched on this earlier, but you happen to be in the fortunate position of Enfield has significant excess capacity, correct? You want to talk about that a little briefly? I think you might have touched on that earlier, but.
Yeah, so when we first installed our quote unquote sewer system, we did not actually have the treatment facility in our municipality. We actually pump our sewage through a very long underground pipe all the way to the city of Lebanon, and then it runs into their interceptor and all the way down to their treatment plant along the Connecticut River. And, we've made investments to actually literally own that capacity that is sort of designated as Enfield's within the Lebanon system. And as I said, we have not even come close to using all of our capacity. So there's room for growth for us. It does present some growth challenges, some growing pains there. As Lebanon found out, I think it was maybe last summer or maybe the summer before, that pipe that interconnects Enfield to Lebanon is actually buried underground and actually goes underneath the Mascoma River. And it turns out that the soil that it's buried in is very acidic, and it's slowly eating away at the ductile iron pipe. And the city of Lebanon is probably staring down some upgrades of their pipe that is connected to us. We do have some trouble lately with Lebanon. They now have levied a development charge So anybody that connects up in Enfield, they have to pay a sort of a double whammy of a connection fee, both an Enfield connection charge and an 11 in development charge. So it's not all roses and unicorns for us. It can be very expensive for a new customer to connect, which is regretful. But, you know, the reality is, as everybody knows, those water treatment plants and DES can speak to this even more. The regulations getting more and more strict, and trying to get rid of these, different contaminants in sewage for treatment are just becoming more and more difficult. We're, you know, dealing with copper and magnesium, and as Brandon alluded to, PFAS is going to be one that we'll probably be dealing with even more as we go forward.
Great. Well, thank you, Rob. Another question, actually a couple questions on the 308 unit development application that you mentioned came in earlier this week. First, will any of the units be affordable? And secondly, where is that project proposed to be located?
So to my knowledge right now, there's nothing in the proposal for quote unquote affordable. They will be market rate. Obviously it takes all kinds to help solve the housing crisis. We do have a very significant need here for Dartmouth. Hitchcock Medical Center has grown substantially with new patient towers, and they're in a sort of a spiral with housing crunch at that facility. Their nurses are living 90 miles from that hospital and, you know, having to commute great distances. So nothing right now in terms of affordability in that development specifically. In our New Hampshire HOP project, we are definitely working with our contractor to improve our affordability regs in our zoning. That development is located, will be located on Route 4 at the very top of what we call Dry Bridge Hill, which is, as you come into Enfield from Lebanon, it's a very steep hill. You come up and that development will actually be on the top of that hill with tremendous views of Mount Cardigan and Mascoma Lake.
Great. Thank you so much. It looks like Brandon may have just answered the last question on PFOA. Up, he put the link to the map. Great. Thank you so much, Brandon. And Brandon, there was also a question about a link to the DES's model groundwater protection zoning. You put the link to that. Brandon, there is one more question about, can the link to the recording be emailed? Yes, as Tim, I think, mentioned at the beginning, everybody that signed up this morning, we'll receive a follow-up email with the link to the YouTube, to the recording on NHMA's YouTube. We will also, OPD will also be posting it on their YouTube, on our YouTube channel and on our plan webinar page. I'm not seeing any additional questions. I'll give folks like one more minute to put questions in the Q&A. Hopefully this has been very informative to everybody. I don't have the ability to put links back out to folks, and I'm sorry we didn't have the slide up, but you should all have a copy of the slides. Everybody that signed up today have a copy of the slides, hopefully in your inbox. It went out earlier this morning. The final slide should include live hyperlinks to register for the remaining three webinars in this Local Solutions to the State's Housing Crisis webinar series. Again, next week's webinar will be YIMBYism, A Different Approach to Development, Thursday, February 29th at 12 p.m. And let's see. Oh, of course, now we're getting... Okay, no more questions. I think we're all good. So thank you, Brandon. Thank you, Rob, so much. I certainly learned a lot today. And everybody have a great week. Good afternoon. Take care.
Thank you.